to Gibraltar is the title of a comprehensive guide to all of Gibraltar's submerged sites, written by Director of Research at the University of Gibraltar, Dr. Darren Farr, and Phil Smith from the Gibraltar Museum. The book traces back the history of shipwrecks that lie within our waters and is filled with valuable information from GPS locations to diving tips within each area.
I've been interested in the sea really since a very young age, particularly diving and the various forms of life that have been there. I was lucky enough to foster this interest to become a biologist and eventually marine biologist, which is really what I specialize the most. And at the same time I developed my diving career and working in the museum, this gave an added value, which essentially was extending that into underwater archaeology and the history of what happened in the sea. So it's really very, very complete and a really wonderful package to be able to look at all of those facets.
I came to Gibraltar in 1981 with the army, and one of the first things I did when I got here was do a diving course, learn to dive, and what I enjoyed most of all was visiting the shipwrecks. So I've had a love affair with Gibraltar's shipwrecks for 34 years now.
Gibraltar is actually quite an interesting location for divers. Personally, I think it's not being marketed enough and people don't know enough about it. It's not the Red Sea, it's not diving in UK waters either. You've got a wonderful mix of Mediterranean and Atlantic marine life. You've also got a tremendous variety of really, really interesting wrecks. You tend to find that divers like one or the other. We have a good selection of both. It makes Gibraltar quite a good place to come diving. Plus the ease, accessibility of the sea and the facilities is something that you don't get everywhere else. There have always been artificial reefs in the sense that very often they've always been shipwrecks, but they weren't purposely sunk in order to generate marine life. What you had, I think, was a retrospective view where people realized, crikey, you know, this big ship has been on the seabed and look at all the life that's around it. So artificial reefs started to come about because of that. Ideally, there are better things to use from artificial reefs than necessarily ships, because at the end of the day it's a hunk of metal sitting on the bottom of the sea. But having said that, it does more than generate, attract a lot of life. What an artificial reef does is, it creates lots of different habitats like holes, crevices, grottos, shaded, bright areas and that. Hard substrates for people, animals to colonize, etc. And the other thing is, most people feel that a sandy seabed, which is full of life, by the way, is like a desert because you can't see it. So people are quite visual, so they like the fact that a reef tends to... The other thing a reef does is it aggregates fish. There's not more fish around necessarily, but because the food that they're eating is on the reef, they all come together. So it gives you the impression that all of a sudden there's more life around. What it does concentrate it, and it does raise the diversity of that area. They can work very well if they're allowed to breed and generate. In other words, if you can create a no-take zone and therefore certain species have a chance to repopulate. Because the sea is the only place, we think about it, as a species we go out hunting every single day. We don't hunt anywhere else really every single day, and the population of the world is continuing to grow dramatically, and everyone still wants that tapita of pulpo and stuff. So it's a tremendous pressure, which we don't realize that we're exerting on the sea. Because when you look at the sea, it always looks the same, nice and blue, and you don't see what's actually going on beneath the surface.
Thank you. biggest threat to our sea life. Bunkering to the great extent does not do a great deal of damage other than anchoring on the seabed, but they've been anchoring on the seabed in deep water for hundreds of years here. Well, not for hundreds of years, but for the last 100 years we've been anchoring boats offshore. We've been bunkering them for the last 20, 30, 40 years. The bunker boats themselves have got permanent anchoring bases in the north end of the basin, which are not doing a great deal of damage to the seabed. Bunkering is going to do a lot of damage to the sea if you have a large spill, but otherwise they do very, very little. Damage in our waters, Mother Nature itself, and men going in there when they suddenly realise there's lots of fish. They're all over the place. We'll come with nets. The spear fishermen come. The aqualung spear fisherman comes along. They come from Spain. We do it ourselves. It's unmonitored. It's very difficult to actually control it, but we're getting there very, very slowly now. Man's the biggest threat, and always has been, and unfortunately always will.
If you go back far enough, 20,000 years ago, the sea level was down 120 metres. So what we have, where we have artificial reefs now and fish are swimming, was dry land. And people like us were hunting red deer and other animals around Gibraltar. This is obviously in historical times this has changed, but even then the profile of Gibraltar has changed dramatically. Many people wouldn't have thought that, for example, Casement Square, where they go every day, was inundated twice a day by the rise and fall of the tide, because it was actually originally a beach. And the area, which is the hole in the ground, which has got a couple of like stone blocks inside it, so it was one wall of a very, very ancient ship repair yard dating back to medieval times. The ships would actually be pushed up out of the sea onto that to be repaired and then pushed back out again. So if you think of that and you think of how much of Gibraltar has been essentially reclaimed and changed, our relationship with the sea has changed a lot over time. We're actually quite lucky in Gibraltar in terms of marine life because we actually are located in the strait, and there's a tremendous amount of water interchange all the time. Luckily, we have quite a good diversity. But yes, but I mean, things have gone extinct. I mean, you can go, things have been going extinct forever. But if I wanted to use an example which is quite recent and maybe people wouldn't think about, if you dig a hole in the ground anywhere in the area of town, you'll come across huge plate-sized oyster shells. Thousands of them. And if you go diving around Gibraltar, you'll not find any oysters anymore. It actually turns out that Gibraltar is quite famous for its oysters. And people used to put their names down in the census as oyster man. And so these were professions. They've gone. We've fished them out completely. And by changing the habitat, actually ended up making them extinct in our waters. So that is something which perhaps would be quite interesting to see if we can bring them back.
The greatest loss that we've had within our waters is the Posidonia. The Posidonia meadows used to cover the whole of the inside of the arbour. People who remember the Montague Basin and the sea bathing pavilion down there, the seabed was covered in what people would call grass, which ostensibly it is. It is a fascicular plant that lives underwater. Absolutely beautiful. And it was in the destroyer prens, but over the passage of time, it has slowly disappeared. It's not disappeared because we've been terrible to it. Off the airport and round the airport, it was the conch rake fishermen that took most of it out. But what's killed it inside the harbour and inside the destroyer pens, and the Montague got buried, of course, is the ships. They got bigger, they got larger, and the stopping and the starting of these ships with the huge propellers creating turbidity in the water were ripping up the Posidonia from the seabed and blackening the water. And people will probably remember looking around from on the upper rock, the big brown stains in the water when ships started to move. That's what destroyed Posidonia here. So we've lost it. We are trying to get it back, but we lost it completely. There was no way of stopping it then. There were no laws to stop it. Now there are. But we don't have the Posidonia. We're trying to bring it back. We lost that. Very sad.
Gibraltar's waters over the years have unfortunately taken a turn for the worse. And this is not something that I'm just coming up with myself, in the sense that, in fact, most of us tend to look at our own lifetime to reflect, and you'll see, well, it's not that much. I mean, I remember when I was little, I used to do this, but it's not when you were little, but it's still relatively recent if we go back. What happens 100 years? Well, we had all these oysters that we were talking about before. If you go even further back, I mean, if I told you that 500 years ago, more tuna were caught at one single Almadraba without the use of any modern facilities than exist nowadays in the entire Western Atlantic. I mean, that's saying something. So you have a situation where pressure, which exists, human pressure for facilities, for the use of the sea, for exploitation of the sea, is actually generating a decrease and a drop in diversity with things like pollution, etc. We can do things about it, and I think we are. Ideally, we should be looking at more sustainable ways of exploiting the sea, because it will continue to be exploited, but it needs to be done in such a way that hopefully people in the future, our children, etc., will still have the sea, not just to be able to go fishing and eat what they catch there, but also to be able to enjoy it and all the many benefits that it gives us, not all of which are necessarily immediately obvious.
What makes our waters special and unique to the, at the end of the day, is all around the bay everything is sandstone. We're Jurassic limestone. We're a huge lump of Jurassic limestone plonked here, which lasts longer. It stands up to wave erosion far, far better than the sandstone does. It's a little piece of Africa on this side of the Mediterranean, as it were. It is as unique as the rock. It's as unique as the monkeys. It is a unique habitat where the biodiversity of sea life here is second to none. You've got from the sea life that people put on their plate to corals that are so colourful, people wouldn't believe it. Not large, but beautiful corals. We have got some fabulous sea life here, and it's our duty to protect it, you know, for future generations. Playing around with artificial reefs for 46 years, well, in another 46 years, you know, when other people come along, what we've done and what we've tried to say may still be there, and you need other people to continue it. Fortunately, government seems to be going down this avenue now, and we should do this all over Europe. Problem is with the sea, at the end of the day, we look at it, it's flat. We swim in it, it's nice. We never think what's living in it. And what's living in our waters, take my word for it, it's unique.